I went to the inauguration of Donald Trump. George W. Bush says to me, well, that was some weird shit.
Most humiliating part
of being nude in the trunk of a car in front of a camera crew is getting out after.
I had a nice seitan.
Number one on Apple.
Wow, they there really put is. A lot
Congrats,
of money
Howard.
Into that.
Congratulations, Howard.
When you just guest hosted on Saturday Night Live,
yeah.
you fucking killed it.
Thank
like
you.
You elevated that show. I said this on the
Excellent
air.
Excellent episode. Yeah.
Thank you.
And
Thank
a couple
you.
Of things stuck out. You did the song about Chris Farley,
yes.
which brought the place down, brought a tear to everyone's eye. It was poignant in the way that like a Bruce Springsteen song. It's like it made
yeah,
you miss the guy, made you think, right?
Right, right.
You did the monologue where
yeah.
you sang too.
About getting fired, yeah.
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Now talk to me about that.
Yes.
Don't you think psychologically, because I was right. watching this thing thinking, Sandler finally had his day because Lorne fired you in some mysterious fucking way. And suddenly you come back to guest host after saying no for all those years. You kill it. And you're probably in the back of your mind saying, still, fuck you.
Look at this.
It's like a drop the mic. There.
Yeah, yeah.
I got to be honest. I didn't have any. I think I might have been like that 15 years ago.
Right.
If I came on and did well and like, yeah. I'm fucking old enough now. I realize what Saturday Night Live did for me, and
but the fire. Let's not downplay this.
But
the firing at the time,
I was hurt because I was. I didn't know what else I was gonna do, and I know it wasn't Lauren's decision. The NBC head dude. I know he didn't like our gang, me and Farley, and
they had a winning cast there, and you had been there for 5 years. You probably would have stayed one or two, at least, maybe more.
Maybe I would have never left because, well, I'm not good at saying goodbye.
But seriously,
they had to get rid of me sometime.
When they fired you, it really caught you by surprise.
Put a lump in my throat only, again.
Everything turned out great. We know that.
Great.
We know the ending of the story. But at the time, you were livid.
I was probably sad into... covering the sadness up with being mad and saying, yeah, fuck you, blah, 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 blah. But I remember when I saw Farley and he said, me too, they don't want me either. We were both like, fuck this shit. We got mad together, pretended we weren't sad and pretended this was for the best. But
who fired? I want to know this. Who fired you?
This is how I got fired. My manager, Sandy, he was talking to me, and I said, yeah, next year on the show, blah, blah, blah. And he's like, maybe you don't go back next year. And I was like, I don't know, man. I still got a few more things. He's like, yeah, but you did it already. And I was like, I did it, but, you know.
He didn't want you to know you were fine.
Yeah, it was one of
make
those.
It seem
he
like
to make
you were
it
quit.
Your idea.
Yeah, yeah, oh, yeah. God. And I was like, yeah, I'll think about it. He's like, I think you thought about it.
Yeah, you've done all the thinking you need to do. When you were standing in the, I guess they call it the Situation Room, behind Obama, they're about to kill bin Laden.
Right.
You knew that was a huge moment, right?
Huge.
Were you thinking again, this could have been my presidency?
No.
Really?
No.
Were you glad in a way it wasn't? Because that's a heavy thing when you see these guys going in. And
there was a split among his advisors. And I was in the small group that said, go after him and go ahead and do it with a Navy SEAL team. It was one of the most intense public experiences I've ever had. And here was, in my view, the right way to make a presidential decision. So there was a small group of us and we were meeting. We met numerous times. We looked at all the different angles. We looked at all of the intelligence to figure out, was this real or not? Final day of our last meeting, he went around the table and he asked everybody to tell him what they thought.
Was Biden there?
Biden was there.
What did he say? Gates, don't do it, right?
Yeah, Biden said don't do it. Gates said don't do it. I mean, you know, because the risks were enormous.
Right.
You were going to fly into Pakistani airspace, land in a place called Abbottabad, which happened to be where the Pakistani military academy is, like West Point, and launch an assault to take out the most horrific terrorist in our history.
So you don't fault Biden for saying no.
Here's my point was, in this room, this was presidential decision making because we all said what we thought, but he had to make the decision. And he said, I'm going to think about it. I'm going to sleep on it. And, you know, I made my case as to why we should do it. I mean, I felt a special responsibility having been in New York the day afterwards and seeing all that.
Were you like, oh, why doesn't he make up his mind? Because why should he sleep on it? Let's get in there.
No, I admired that.
You did?
Yes. I do not like impulsive decision makers.
Right.
Because.
And he also listens to other people.
He listens and he probes. And why do you believe that? And why don't you believe that?
You watched Bin Laden die.
No, the video ended when the SEALs got into the complex, into the buildings.
Because of a technical reason or because you didn't want it?
Didn't. I think both. Remember, I agreed with the president as well not to release pictures.
Wow. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Here's a story that I like to tell because most people don't know it. You know about the SEALs going in. You may know that one of the helicopters crashed.
That's right.
Luckily, we had tried to think of every possible scenario. So there had been another helicopter positioned nearby to come in to take out the SEALs. But the one that had crashed was a new stealth helicopter. It had to be blown up so that the technology wouldn't fall into the wrong hands. They kill Bin Laden. They have to take his body out because we have to do the DNA back when they get to Afghanistan. Those Navy SEALs, after having shot their way into that, killed the Kuwaiti courier, killed his brother, killed one of Bin Laden's adult sons, wounded one of the women who was after them. They took the women and children out, and they took them to the other side of this big compound, as far away from the helicopter explosion as they could, so they wouldn't be injured. Now, that's when I think about the American military, that's who I think about. And I am sick to my stomach about what Trump did, pardoning three men who had been were testified against by their own men because of the way they behaved.
What is that?
Well, I don't know what it is. It's his perverse understanding of courage and war.
In other words, there are rules.
There have to be rules. That's why I was so proud to tell that story. What other military
would do that?
All of a sudden, people are waking up. We're monitoring all the chatter. People are waking up. They're climbing to their roofs. They're only a mile away from this military academy. And our guys take the time to move this family around. First of all, they didn't kill him. And then they brought him to safety. That's the American military that I know.
It moves me. It moves me when you describe this. It brings tears to my eyes.
Mine too, still.
Because what a great bunch of guys.
That's honor. That is honor.
And so you can't undermine that military experience and the command,
exactly.
The chain of command.
And that level of quality of service.
Exactly.
Hey, you shouldn't be in here. We just switched off the ventilation system.
Benjy proved to me the guy has absolutely no acting talent. He's the worst actor ever.
Oh, dear.
Benji's just downright bad because he's done Sharknado. And you know how he always screams and yells?
Yes.
Repent, sinners! He has seen what you have done! He will destroy even that hurt!
That seems to be the only thing he can do, no matter what the show, no matter what the part.
You're kidding. He did this?
Yeah, I can't wait to play this for you.
With the bold and beautiful as well?
There's no nuance to this guy's work. Here it is. It's just this woman who is a major player on the show encounters a hazmat worker. The hazmat worker says three lines. This is how he sounds during the rehearsal of this.
Hey Benjy.
Hey! You shouldn't be in here! We just switched off the ventilation system!
Interface with
it. You need to go! Now!
Hey, Benjy, let me fill you in again. Right now you're at a 10. Take it down to a 5. Like, you're not angry with her, it's more concern. Try it again for me right now.
Hey! You shouldn't be in here! We just switched off the ventilation system!
Does he have
you
a hearing problem?
Now!
That was better.
No, it wasn't.
I'm watching the meter, and it stays the same.
Robin, he went from a 10 to a 9.9. She said, take it down.
She said, have that. Take it down to 5.
She should have just said, hey, stop being an asshole.
And just say these lines.
Yeah, try it less shitty next time, okay? This is the same acting performance he did in Sharknado.
You must repent! The end is near! Repent! Repent! No!
The decision was made to put him in the mask for the actual shooting of the scene because they probably figured it would tone him down.
Yeah.
This is how it sounded. This is the actual scene now. Okay?
Action. Hey, you should be in here. We just got the ventilation system. You need to go now.
And clear.
Sounds like Benjy. Thank you.
It's like Hannibal Lecter.
They're cheering because he's leaving.
I'm like Blobby De Niro.
He sounds like, you know what he sounds like? Like Bane, you know, like he's got the mask on. And he's like,
well, he was already having trouble getting ventilation system out without a mask. So this didn't help at all.
Hey, Benjy Puppy, let me hear your performance.
I wish that.
And what was the director's one note? It was, can you please act like you're not yelling at her?
She asked for five.
I don't do five.
you're amped up at a nine.
I'm always at a nine.
You're either a 10 or a nine.
Yeah, yeah. I'm like Marlon Blobdo.
So we were really curious to see what the final product looked like.
Right.
So here it is now. Here's Benjy on The Bold and the Beautiful.
Thomas.
The worst fucking thing.
Wow. It really is Fred's impression.
And they drowned him out with music,
yeah.
too.
And they put him in echo. They did everything they could.
All right, Benjy, now you can come in. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the worst actor ever on the planet.
If they ever give out that award.
They covered his face, played music over him. Anything to drown him out. You're maybe the worst actor I've ever seen. Honest to God, couldn't you just say, ma'am, you got to leave?
Well,
let's try it.
Hey, we just switched off the ventilation system.
Why do you have trouble with the word ventilation?
Hey, no, I didn't like the word switch.
Ventilation.
Ventilation.
Yeah, just say, ma'am, you got to leave. We're in the middle of switching off the ventilation system. There's poisonous gas in the air, so you have to go.
Ma'am, you got to leave. There's poisonous gas in the air. You got to go.
In the air.
In the air.
Yeah.
Air.
What's going on?
Air.
Talk like when you're talking to me. Just say, hey, just tell me that there's poisonous gas in the air and that
Howard,
you have to
you
leave.
You got to get out of here. There's poisonous gas in the air.
Have you ever taken acting lessons?
Yes.
You have?
Yes.
Where?
Maybe you shouldn't say.
Okay.
You'll put them out of business.
At the Home Depot.
What method did you study? The Stella Adler or
like things related to Meisner, maybe.
Meisner?
Like, yeah.
This guy Meisner's got to be pissed.
Sanford,
I don't know who
Sanford,
he is.
Sanford,
one time he gets mentioned.
Benjy Puppet, did you go to Meisner? Or did you go, too?
Yeah, yeah. It was Sid Meisner.
Sid Meisner.
Sid Meisner.
I think you might have the wrong Meisner.
It was his cousin.
Hello. So there was a liquor company that came to us. I wish I could remember who it was. And they had created a word. It was a word that didn't exist. It was a made-up word.
That was here?
It was here.
Yeah.
The word was farfoof.
Farfoof?
Farfoof. Okay.
Good thing they didn't tell me
about
this.
And they were going to pay, I believe it was at least $1 million. And the premise was for 3 months, you were just supposed to weave the word into the fabric of the show.
Like now, how are you supposed to do this?
Like, Gary, you're such a farfoof.
Farfoofooey. Farfoofooey. Like, I would say, in other words, I would make the word farfoof cool.
Yeah, Gary, you really farfoofed that one.
You farfoofed that.
Yeah. And you were supposed to do it.
And then people would say, what is that?
And then that's when the ad campaign starts, Robin.
And then I really look like a tool.
Right.
Like farfoof instead of hey now.
I guess.
Farfoof.
They never said what it meant. The whole idea was it's a word that can mean anything. Howard could do anything with it.
God. Can you imagine? And then Robin looking at me with disdain. Robin, farfoof. It's not
Thank
even a
you.
Funny word.
No.
Farfoof.
What are you doing over there?
I would have said to him, fuck farfoof. Ronnie said ash treaks.
Yeah.
Ash treaks.
We'll sell him that word. We're already down the pike with that one.
I think the premise was that they can't use ass treaks in the TV ads that they run outside of here.
New ass treaks whiskey.
Ass treaks.
Ass treaks.
Ass treaks.
Do you want to do?
Do. We could have sold them do.
Do.
Instead of dude.
Ass treaks.
Do.
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 That would work.
I'm telling you.
Do.
You know, I went to the inauguration of Donald Trump, which was one of the hardest days of my life, to be honest.
I am consumed with that. I was thinking about you that day. I was watching you more than I was watching Trump. First of all, I don't even know how you get past
you got 3 million more votes than the guy.
I did, right.
In my mind, you won the election. The Electoral College, I can't explain that. I don't under, I think it was for some farmer who felt that he was, his rights were going to be denied. But the majority of the people in the country voted for you.
You're right.
You got the job done.
Right.
When you're standing there watching this guy, what the hell is going through your head? Are you just, I would imagine you were on antidepressants that day.
You know, how? Here's how I felt about it. I mean, obviously, I was crushed. I was disappointed. And I was really surprised because I couldn't figure out what had happened.
And you hadn't even written a losing speech when you lost that night. You had only had victory in mind.
No, and everything was pointed in that direction. So when he's going to be inaugurated, I was going as a former first lady.
Right.
That was the reason I was there. I was no longer in the Senate. I was, secretaries of state don't usually attend. So I was
But your
go.
Sense of duty is,
yes.
My husband was president, I was
right.
first lady,
right.
and this is what we say to the country. There's continuity.
That is exactly how I felt. And a lot of people said to me, don't put yourself through that, don't go. And I said, look, I ran for president because I love this country. I wanted to serve this country. I thought I would have been a really good president. I want him
you would
to,
have been you would have been spectacular
well,
with
I
all
hope
your
so.
Experience
yeah I hope
foreign
so.
Affairs
yep but
would
I,
you be crushing NATO right now? I don't think so.
No we need them, but
so
I,
you're
but,
standing up there.
So I said to myself, I said to everybody who talked to me about it, look, I hope he's going to be a better president than I think he will be. I'm worried about it, but I'm going to do everything I can, as I told him when I called him, you know, that terrible night. And
oh, you
said,
did call him.
Oh,
that
I
night.
Did. I said, you know, I said, look, you know, Donald, I want you to be a good president. I will do whatever I can to help you. So, you know, we're in that
period. Was he
period.
Gracious or was he a sore winner?
He was so shocked he couldn't, I mean, he could barely form a sentence.
He was as shocked as you.
He was more shocked than me, I think.
Wow. But, he was shocked.
Yeah, he was shocked.
All right.
And so when I got there, you know, go ahead, get out there. You put on the best face possible. And I'm, you know, Bill and I are sitting with George and Laura Bush. And then he started on that speech, which was so bizarre. And that's when I got really worried. I thought, wait a minute.
If this isn't rational.
It's not rational, but it's also not, it's not politics. It's not what a president does. A president is supposed to try to reach out to people who weren't for
right.
him or her. You're supposed to say, okay, I'm going to be the president of everyone, those who supported me and those who didn't, because we're going to pull the country together. I'd hoped that I would hear a little of that. I didn't hear any of that. And then that carnage in the street and the dark dystopian vision, I was sitting there like, just, wow, couldn't believe it. And George W. Bush says to me, well, that was some weird shit.
Wow.
We're docking. This is called docking.
Yeah. Sal and Richard have put together something. They're going to come in here nude, Robin, to brace yourself.
Oh, God.
And they're going to, how do you describe this, Gary? What are they going to be doing, the guys?
So they're holding a banner. There's
right.
a banner that's going to celebrate what's going on.
You guys, you're completely nude.
Yes.
Except for that.
It's an honor of you, Howard.
Belt. The belt that's holding their mic pack.
Yeah, the belt holds their, these guys love to be naked. Sal and
we've been naked 10,000 hours on this show.
Yeah.
We're experts.
Howard, there's a little room back there,
yeah.
right? And we were all waiting back there.
Right.
Till you called us in.
Yeah.
I had to leave. The room smelled.
It was your breath.
I mean, you have to have clothes on. I mean,
you think it was Gary's breath?
It was Gary's breath. Yeah.
It was breath.
You got a whiff of your teeth, Gary.
Yeah.
It
smells worse than my ass.
Does Richard smell?
His cock does reek a little bit today.
Yeah. Why?
Yeah. As soon as he dropped his pants, everybody got a little bit of a
wafting. I don't believe you. You better get down and smell it.
No, we smelled
Seriously,
it.
Does it smell, Richard? What's going on?
It might. I didn't know we were going to do this.
So what happened?
What do you mean you didn't like?
So you didn't bathe this month?
Your cock isn't clean most of the time, at least to start the day.
No.
When's the last time you bathed your cock?
I think Sunday.
Oh,
oh my God. So 2 days of fermentation is there.
Yeah.
Then why would you take off your clothes?
Because it's our job.
Gary, does it smell really bad over there?
Like, I went in the room, and the room is like, because it's a small room, so it's a little warm. And then it's just like, was a smell. And so the guys will tell you I was not fucking around.
Right.
I was in there for 45 seconds, and I go, I apologize, guys. Something smells in this room, and I went and waited out front.
And Sal, it's not you, right?
No, it's not me.
Right.
I mean, Gary, get a whiff of my cock and let me know if it stinks.
Yeah, come on, Gary. You have to see who it is.
I swear I won't do a thing.
I will fuck you up.
Don't do anything, though.
I promise.
Yeah, he's afraid they'll
take a whiff of mine.
His cock.
Nothing there.
Nothing.
You didn't get close enough.
Now, smell Richard. And Richard,
look at Richard.
Don't move, Richard. Is it bad? Seriously?
Wow. It's yeasty. Right?
What does it smell like?
You okay?
It's like, it's like, you know when you like you own a cabin and you haven't opened up the windows for the whole summer? Yeah. That's what it's moldy.
Richard, aren't you ashamed?
Really, no, I'm proud.
How is this honoring my book going to number
one? What are you doing,
I'm prepping.
Come on, Sal.
So we have disgusting. Like a, it's like a roll of wrapping paper, and that's what's holding the banner up. So each of the guys is going to put their dick in the hole.
We're docking. This is called docking.
Yeah. All right.
There we go.
All right, there they go.
And then I will pull the string here.
You really think that's going to hold?
Let's see, Robin. So. What they're doing is their dicks are holding up a banner that celebrates this the book your... being number
yeah,
one.
Yeah, their dicks are like the toilet paper holder.
That's right. Their dicks are like the toilet paper holder, and the toilet paper will be me.
And the piece of shit is Gary.
Number one on Apple.
Wow, they there really put a lot
Congrats,
of money
Howard.
Into that.
Yeah.
Congratulations, Howard.
Thank you, guys. I'm moved.
Thank you, Howard.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congrats,
yeah.
Howard.
Oh, there's the photographer.
And here comes
Don't
the photographer.
Move.
Don't move, guys. Say cheese.
Cheese. Dick cheese.
There you go. When you did the movie with Jennifer Aniston, Murder
yeah,
Mystery,
yeah, yeah.
You have a makeout scene with her.
Yes.
Yeah, and listen, she's a very nice-looking woman.
She's a great lady.
But your yes. mother can't... Your mother.
Your right. mother.
Sorry, sorry. Your mother. Your I got issues. Your wife comes with you to the set.
Yeah.
A murder mystery, and she's telling you, you've got to make out more with Jennifer. Oops. She encouraged you to really go in there because you were probably trying to be respectful.
I'm always trying to be respectful, but my wife's... first of all, my wife loves Aniston, thinks she's
right.
the greatest.
Of course.
Whenever Jennifer texts my wife, it's great. She smiles and she loves
Excited.
It so much. She just loves everything Jennifer has to say about anything. And then, right. if Jennifer says
right.
says about, you know, like, did you hear this new drink? And my wife... You've got to drink that drink. Blah, blah, blah.
You do.
Yeah.
Right,
oh,
right.
She's already drinking it. Right. Jackie's
but
already.
But your wife gave you tips for kissing Jennifer Aniston.
Yes, she said don't ever. She did the same thing for Uncut Gems.
Well, Uncut Gems.
Yeah, I was going to say, there are beautiful women in Uncut Gems, and you're making out.
She jumps.
We don't see Adam Sandler fucking a lot in his movies, but in Uncut Gems.
Hey,
says,
oh,
let's,
I guess
yeah.
it looks
what
like
do you mean, don't
gonna...
downplay it?
I don't know, man.
Huh?
It's disgusting.
Is it disgusting to see you on film fucking?
It's disgusting in all film to see me.
Listen, and aren't you nude in the trunk of a car?
That's horrible,
oh,
too.
Oh, my God.
Everything's horrible.
When you shoot that,
involved.
Are you nude?
There were nude moments, yes.
Right.
I would gladly ask a crew member to bring a towel over quickly. That, the most humiliating part of being nude in the trunk of a car in front of a camera crew is getting out after.
Oh, my God. Were
like,
you really fully nude?
Well, I was covering my
your
dick.
Junk. With your hand? Or
it was. I think there was a sweatshirt in the trunk.
Dirty rag.
anything but showing that.
Oh.
Yeah, no.
Oh,
it was
my
horrible.
God. I can't imagine. Oh, it's just horrible. That would have been, I wouldn't have taken the movie just for that.
It certainly made taking the movie a little more difficult when I read, fucking naked, man. I don't want to be naked.
Yeah, it's okay. It was all right.
It's okay. It's all right. It's all right. Yeah.
Actually, JD had Thanksgiving dinner at the vegetarian restaurant.
Well, that sounds like JD.
But, like, what a change in JD. This is
He'll
like,
follow that girl anywhere.
Oh, my God. That wife has whipped him into shape.
It's not a whipping into shape. He's like your dog.
Yeah.
Not completely like that.
You're like a dog, Robin says.
Yeah, she sees you. I heard her.
How'd you like that vegetarian food? I'm a big fan.
They have a great. They do great stuff.
Yeah, it was all right. I had a nice seitan. It was okay.
A seitan?
Who cooked it? Satan? What's a seitan?
Is that like a mushroom or whatever?
No, it's a wheat product.
Oh, that's right. That, okay.
It's like a mushroom or whatever. No, Robin goes, it's a wheat product. That's the furthest thing from a mushroom.
Whatever.
A lot of things are mushrooms and vegan, so that's what I thought.
You liked it, though.
Yeah, it's okay. It was all right.
I was shocked they don't have like the that new veggie burger. None of these places have it. It's so good.
I've been to a vegetarian restaurant that had it.
I did too.
Can't believe like you branched out, dude.
Well, I mean, I got like turkey and stuff during the day for me.
Oh.
JD and his wife watched the Thanksgiving Day parade balloons get blown up. Did you know that?
Oh, they went to the park.
Yeah.
And did that romantic thing.
Well, I don't know why they went.
In twilight.
Oh, something to do. Neither of us thought the parade would be too long and stuff to go through. So we thought we'd check out the balloons getting blown up.
I can't understand.
Neither of us thought the parade would be too long to go to.
That's what I said.
You know what I meant.
I don't.
I'll have the seitan and the cooker and some pounder.
Seitan.
Yeah.
I can't believe he ordered seitan.
The seitan piccata.
He doesn't even know what it is. Like, I got wheat balls and spaghetti because I know what that is. I think I've had tempeh.
It's in Arizona, I think.
It's a mushroom.
Did you have it? Tempeh? I have the tempeh and the zucchini enchilada with a side order of the lentils and tempeh and the pinto pulp.
Wow.
Or whatever. You know what I mean.
Jalapeno.
Hey now. Ronnie, you're not wearing shoulder pads, are you?
No.
That was the rumor over here.
Lifts in shoulder pads now?
Someone says you're wearing shoulder pads.
It's a suit.
Oh.
That's my suit.
So you don't have shoulder pads.
No. You touched it before.
Didn't feel like it
No,
to
it
me.
Was Jason. Jason has issues, I guess, you know, because he can't wear any clothes. Oh. Right. He wears a fucking tent to work every day.
Oh, my God. A moo-moo. Why are you spreading rumors about Ron?
Dude, yesterday Ronnie had about... Had about 3 extra inches on his shoulder.
Really?
Not just a suit. I know what a shoulder pad and a suit feels like. It's wearing
a different jacket. What are you so worried about what I wear?
I'm not worried about what you wear. I'm just reporting on it.
You wear the same fucking sweatshirt every day.
So go tell Howard about it. What do you want from me? You're wearing shoulder pads? I'm not going to tell somebody.
I'm shoulder pads,
did you wear
okay?
shoulder pads yesterday?
No.
And I had JD go double check, and he did. He put his hands all
there
over
them. There were shoulder pads.
Dude, they were huge.
When they make a suit, they put pads in there to make the jacket look
I know about even, pads, okay? But your pad was like 6 inches thick.
No, it wasn't six. I'll wear the same suit Monday that I wore yesterday, okay?
I touched this suit. It's not the
Why
same suit.
Why are you
suit.
Touching me?
To see if you have shoulder pads on.
He said he'll wear it on Monday. He's not saying today's the same suit.
Right. Right.
Let me ask you something, though, because Ronnie wears his shirt unbuttoned now, and there's always a little T-shirt under it.
That's right. That's his new look.
What is that look? Is that
It's my new change for right now, okay? Is that a problem?
It's his new casual
I don't laugh
look.
At your clothes. What's, since, you know, since we you made him get rid of his whole outfit.
We made him get rid of his mock turtleneck, and now he's doing
okay,
that.
Okay, so now
What's
he's
the
doing
deal?
The... Yeah, and now today, the T-shirt is matching the shirt. Do you notice that?
Yeah, he looks good. It's Ronnie's way of saying, okay, I have to wear a suit to work, but I'm edgy.
I'm not really sure I like the T-shirt under the you know, tailored shirt.
It's his Miami Vice look. You know, it's like, hey, I'm not going to wear a tie. I'm a rebel, even though I have to wear a suit.
I like it.
Hey, Ron, can I be honest with you?
What?
The rumor I heard, and be honest, answer.
What?
Are you plucking your eyebrows?
No, I'm not
Come
plucking
on.
Them.
What are you doing?
No, I trim them. Every once in a while, I have to trim them, you know? Trying to groom a little bit, you know?
Look at that close-up.
That's terrible.
He's plucking
his eyebrows.
Yeah,
I did a horrible job.
Yeah, that's not plucking.
No, I didn't pluck them. I trimmed them.
You're doing a terrible job. Can I be honest
I know
with you?
I said I did a shit job, okay?
Because it looks like he shaved off your eyebrows.
I know.
Yeah, looks like an accident.
It was an accident. I went too far.
Okay? How do you trim them? With what?
One of those buzzer things.
But why are you trimming your eyebrows? I don't do that.
Because it got a little fuzzy, you know?
Oh, yeah? Look at the close-up on that.
I'll do a little trim.
Seriously, you're close to just shaving them off and then drawing in your eyebrows.
Really?
No, I'm not going to do
that.
That's
what women do.
Dude, I made a mistake.
Dude, seriously? That's unfucking real.
Seriously, I made a mistake, for God's sakes.
Yeah. And what are those new glasses? Those are very expensive Bulgaria glasses, right?
Dude, I've been wearing these for over a year already. Where have you been?
No, those are expensive.
Bulgari.
Yeah.
Bulgari.
They were $500.
Wow. High roller.
Good for you.
But look at those eyebrows.
Dude.
Robin, do you see that?
I see. That's a mess.
He shaved his eyebrows. I can't believe what I'm saying.
He's got a 5 o'clock.
Dude, I didn't shave him. I didn't mean to shave him. I just told you that.
How often do you shave your eyebrows?
I don't shave them.
Yeah, whatever it is that
you
do.
I was trimming them.
How often do you do that?
Whatever I feel like I want, it has to be done, okay?
Well, is one of
I don't set a calendar date.
Are those trimmers, though, the kind of thing that leaves the 5 o'clock shadow?
He's probably using the wrong trimmer.
Oh.
No, what happened was,
he went
Fred,
too close.
Yeah, exactly. There's the setting thing on it.
Yeah.
Well, I used the wrong setting. Okay.
All right, thank you, Ron.
All right, man.
It's weird. I can't believe Ronnie shaves his eyebrows.
I'm not shaving him.
I heard you love Fabian.
I did.
Fabian, Fabian, you know, my sister loved Fabian.
Back in the day.
You were in the Fabian fan club?
What? Tell your sister I was, for Fabian? A short period of time, I was the president of the Fabian
oh
fan
my
club.
Do you
feel it only
silly
had two
now.
Other people in it.
Yeah, yeah, do you feel silly saying that now in light of history?
No, because I was so young and he was so cute.
He was your fantasy.
Yes.
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 But of the Beatles, it was Paul.
It
right?
was always Paul.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I Paul go way back with Paul.
What? You know what? To me, those guys, they taught me more than anyone.
And still do.
They do.
I mean, you put on White Album, you listen to that, you learn something every time.
It's unreal.
It is unreal.
I was thinking of a John Lennon lyric the other day, and I went, oh, that's what he meant. I'm just starting to get it.
Yeah. Hey, Jude. I mean, think about it.
All of it.
All of
it.
I mean, I find their music to be so not just a part of my past. Like I have a lot of music that's part of my past. This is like past, my present, and my future.
Were you a rock fan?
I was. Yeah.
You wouldn't go to a Zeppelin concert, though, would you?
No, I didn't ever. I didn't. But I went to the first Rolling Stones concert that ever came to Chicago back in the early, you know, to mid 60s.
Are they the world's greatest rock and roll band?
They're amazing.
They are.
They are amazing.
Because of the amount of material that this band put out.
Yeah. And look, their staying power, their stamina, it's inspirational to people like
it
me.
It is. How is he alive?
I don't know.
And how is Keith Richards alive?
That's the more interesting question.
Yeah, I mean, there's something to investigate.
But his book was brilliant.
Keith's.
Oh, God, yes.
How do the Rolling Stones stay together after Keith slaughtered Mick Jagger in that book?
Mick is a really pragmatic guy.
Do you know Mick?
I do.
I've never met him.
Oh,
I want to meet him.
Oh, you would love him.
Where do you meet Mick?
Oh, gosh. I met him first probably in the White House. I don't know.
He came to see you.
When you're in the White House, you can invite anybody to come see you, I
what
guess.
Do you say to these people? Do you fan out over them or do
my
you just
be cool?
My mother
loved the Rolling Stones.
That's progressive.
So the Rolling Stones were at the Beacon Theater. I think it was a Scorsese filming. Mm. So we were invited.
Oh, yes.
I brought my mother. I thought she was going to pass out. And you know who her favorite was? Keith Richards.
Oh,
well,
my
yeah.
goodness.
So because my mother loved Keith Richards, we asked if he would call her on her birthday. And he did. It was like the best birthday she ever had.
The fact that Mick Jagger could be in a band with this guy who now badmouths him. It'd be like if you hung out with Trump after all the things
yeah,
he said
about
you. Yeah,
that would be hard.
Right?
That would be hard.
But Keith treats Mick like he's Trump.
Well, but they've been together for so long. And I think, I don't know. I think they understand each other.
It's unbelievable.
Bye for now.
The Howard Stern Show.